In situations like these, we usually give some semblance of a talk related to our research. And I'm actually not going to do that right now. I'm going to talk about something that to me is much bigger than my research, and that very much is about what I do with my students through my teaching. I teach at a small liberal arts college, like Percival said, about an hour and a half south of Denver. Colorado College, it has about 2,200 undergraduates and only one graduate program, and that is in my education department. It's a Master's of Arts in Teaching. I'm also in the third most conservative city in the country, so it makes it very interesting to do the work that I do and to teach the topics that I teach in that kind of environment. We have 200 faculty members, of whom 7 are Black, 2 are Asian, 3 are Native American, and about a handful identify as Latinx. And the rest of my colleagues pretty much blend in seamlessly with our surrounding city. I wasn't really surprised at the makeup of the faculty body, as most colleges and universities are pretty much predominantly white institutions, have predominantly white faculty. But I was a bit surprised by the composition of the student body. So of our 2,200 undergraduates, 2/3 of them write a $64,000 check every year to pay tuition. And I remember teaching my first class, which I co-taught with my chair, who is a white male. And I don't remember what we were talking about, but I mentioned Section 8 housing in passing and kind of kept going. And my chair interrupted me and was like, "Manya, they don't know what that is." And I'm like, "Oh, whatever, Mike, they know what that is." But 2 minutes later, it became clear. They had no idea what I was talking about. And in another course that same year, I think it was an intro course, I asked the students to raise their hands if they drove a luxury vehicle. And nobody raised their hand. And I was confused because I'd seen them, right, in their luxury SUVs. And so I was like, oh, okay, I got it. So I went to the board, wrote on the board, BMW, Audi, Benz, Lexus, and so on. I said, now raise your hand if you drive one of those, right? And about 85% of the hands went up. And they're like, why is that a luxury vehicle? I was like, okay, everybody get up, right? So we went to the parking lot, and we looked at my 2002 Oldsmobile Alero. And for the most part, they were stunned, right? And after they got really settled, after they were excited about touching fabric on seats for the first time, right? We went back in the classroom. And that's when I realized that what I thought I was going to be teaching about that day was not what I was going to be teaching about. So then I put them in small groups, and we did an exercise that I now call budget busters, where I give them scenarios, a monthly budget, and they have to figure out how to allocate their money based upon how much debt they owe, all these other pieces. I also taught them what a car note was and how to calculate interest, which was fun. I know none of this sounds much like what you think I should be doing in an education course, but the reality is that I can't teach content when they don't have the context. Right? So although I am in an education department, I'm not teacher education faculty. My official title is Assistant Professor of Social and Political Issues in Education. So I teach courses on urban ed, diversity and equity in education, ed policy, ed reform, ed psych. So basically all my classes are about access and opportunity in education. Now this wasn't what I was hired to teach, but I realized early on that this is what I need to teach. Right. I thought at first I would get in trouble, whatever that means, for not teaching to the test, like we say in education. But when that didn't happen, I really embraced the idea that I'm not a professor to teach traditionally. I'm a professor to give the students what they need, and that's equity. And it very much is at the core of what I do in my teaching and my research. My mentor in graduate school, Dr. Rich Milner, who is now at University of Pittsburgh, has a saying, and I absolutely love it. He says, to meet them where they are, but don't stay there. And this phrase very much embodies what I do and provides a rationale for why I do it. And to me, the sentiment of forward motion is at the core of what I call pedagogical activism. Now, I call it pedagogical activism. Some people call it intellectual activism. It really doesn't matter what you call it. It's about embracing the reality of the now and responding to it. So right now, our colleges and universities are experiencing an upsurge in hate crimes, and in response, the emergence or reemergence of student activism. Many faculty and administrators brush aside students' protests and petitions and walkouts and teach-ins as things that are beyond the scope of their job duties. right? But what the students do outside of class isn't of concern to so many faculty, but in my mind, it really should be. Because the students are not petitioning about everything except your class, right? They're demanding a revision of institutional structures and functioning. And as the representative of the institution with whom students most often interact, I believe we have a responsibility to respond. So in that respect, activism is very much about counteractions. In education, we talk about counter-narratives, right? And counter-narratives emerge in response to master narratives that silence the voices and perspectives of those most oppressed by some kind of systemic action. Counteractions like counter-narratives are intended to disrupt the status quo by highlighting the ways in which the initial action marginalizes or ignores particular people, spaces, or experiences. So pedagogical activism is about teaching to make evident the systems and structures of oppression and to prepare students to interact with them. So in this talk, I'll discuss the ways in which both historically and in the contemporary moment, truth and knowledge have been obscured by power and privilege, and how student activism works to dismantle social, political, and economic structures. Most of all, I'll describe how through our pedagogy, faculty can embrace and bolster student activism in an effort to prepare them to thrive in the current socio-political context. To do so, I'll draw parallels between what's happening now and what's happened before on college campuses, primarily relying on the civil rights movement. Then I'll go on to define social justice pedagogy and outline how to enact it. So I begin way back in the beginning. In 1954, the cumulative outcome of five separate cases, commonly known as Brown versus Board of Education, was to overturn the 1896 result of Plessy versus Ferguson of separate but equal. Brown versus Board of Education found that segregated public schooling was unconstitutional because, quote, separate educational facilities are inherently unequal, end quote. Embedded in these court cases are arguments about access to high quality schools and debates about the lack of transportation to and from schools, overcrowded classrooms, and not enough resources. The Supreme Court decided that integrating schools would address these concerns, but in reality, this only served to expose what was always the real problem: racial hierarchies that marginalize, oppress, and disenfranchise black students. If we fast forward 60 years, 18-year-old Mike Brown is killed by police in Ferguson, Missouri. This sparked national outrage, particularly among black college students who felt that in conjunction to the 2000 acquittal of George Zimmerman and Trayvon Martin's murder, it represented the myriad of ways in which race, law, and power intersect. The following year saw the growth of the Black Lives Matter movement along with the Black Liberation Collective. These are national organizations started by young activists committed to calling out and ending anti-black racism. So I want to show a quick clip.
Today, we interrupt the daily routine of Princeton students, faculty, and staff to draw attention to a national problem, a national disease, the plague that is American racism and racialized state violence. It's one that has terrorized our communities, threatened our humanity, and taken the lives of our people. We walk out in solidarity today, in part, to fight for inclusion on a campus and in a country where we have to prove our worth in order to earn respect, to fight for progress on a campus and in a country where our bodies have been stigmatized, our minds distorted, our voices muted, and to fight for our humanity on a campus and in a country where our lives are considered to be less than fully human. So today, we interrupt Princeton as the lives of many black Americans, countless, have been and continue to be interrupted constantly by the oppressive culture of systemic racism. So we are here, in part, for Ferguson and for Mike Brown, but not just for Ferguson and for Mike Brown. Our purpose is far greater. Our mission extends to thousands, to millions of black bodies, imprisoned in silence, imprisoned in death, imprisoned in their own blackness by the American racial state.
We stand in solidarity with the people of Ferguson and others in demanding an end to racialized state violence. The issue of racialized state violence has eliminated racial issues existing on campus that we aim to transform. Furthermore, we aim to dismantle systemic injustices against marginalized people of color. We challenge our campus to stand in the nation's service and fight for justice by rejecting the culture of apathy and by reviving Princeton's tradition of protest. By remaining... By remaining silent, we are all complicit in this violence. Yes. Yes. No justice.
No peace.
So by the end of fall semester 2015, over 80 colleges and universities experienced some kind of student-led protest against systemic and structural racism on campus. Among their demands, students listed a diversified faculty, inclusive curriculum, divestment from prisons, and the removal of culturally insensitive symbols, mascots, and language. The backlash against students cited their fragility and sense of entitlement as an affront to philosophies of meritocracy that embrace equality rather than equity. I was surprised at the outrage I saw on my own Facebook news feed because to me this was very much inevitable. As a college professor, I interact with students on a daily basis, not just in our three-hour courses every day, but in my office where students of color, queer students, immigrant students, and students from low-income families come to hang out. In the 5 years I've been at my present institution, I've witnessed a shift in their language and their attitudes. Whereas they were once accepting of, if not happy, about their experiences as some kind of minority at a PWI, the students are now impassioned and vocal. Unbeknownst to many of my colleagues, they are always organizing, joining national networks, and educating themselves on how to affect change and demand social justice. They are, in essence, following in the footsteps of student activists from the 1960s. In 1960 at Shaw University, a historically black institution in North Carolina, the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, or SNCC, was created by Ella Baker. Ella was at that time the executive director of the Southern Christian Leadership Conference, or the SCLC, that was led by Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. But Ella felt that the SCLC was out of touch with the needs of black youth. In the months preceding this, college students in Greensboro had organized to stage sit-ins at all white businesses, and Ella wanted to formalize and centralize their political activities. Though SNCC did endorse the philosophy of nonviolence, unlike the SCLC, SNCC believed that nonviolence was one strategy of protest, not the only strategy of protest. SNCC wanted more than racial integration and more than equality with whites. SNCC advocated and fought for a complete restructuring of social systems. SNCC grew beyond Shaw University with chapters in many HBCUs in the South. Fisk University in Nashville, Tennessee became a hub of activity, partnering with nearby Meharry Medical College, Tennessee State University, and American Baptist Theological Seminary. They were led by Fisk student Diane Nash. Black college students, therefore, were organized and strategic. They recruited members, read literature, invited speakers, conducted trainings for how to protest, and established a political agenda that would change the course of history. In 1961, SNCC joined with the Congress of Racial Equality, CORE, to facilitate and participate in the Freedom Rides. These were interstate bus trips throughout the South to test the validity of Boynton versus Virginia that determined that segregated bus terminals were unconstitutional. On May 4, 1961, 13 black and white activists left Washington, D.C., headed to New Orleans by May 17th to commemorate the anniversary of Brown versus Board of Education. After traveling through Virginia and North Carolina, on May 12th in Rock Hill, South Carolina, John Lewis, who in January was criticized as being all talk and no action by President Trump, along with white activist Albert Bigelow, were attacked while trying to enter an all-white waiting area. Days later, two buses of Freedom Riders were stopped in Alabama. Their buses were bombed, and while trying to escape, riders were brutally beaten by white mobs. This pattern continued for months, during which the Freedom Rides gained national attention. The FBI, who had been wiretapping SNCC for 7 years, raided SNCC offices, accusing them of domestic terrorism. Amidst riots and weakening financial support, Stokely Carmichael left SNCC to join the Black Panther Party, and H. Rapp Brown took over as chairman until 1970, when he went underground to avoid arrest and the group disbanded. 2 years ago, I taught a class on the civil rights and HBCUs, and I'll talk more about that later. But I want to say now that while many of you in the room know this story, I was stunned that my students did not. Even my black students had never heard of CORE or SNCC or the SCLC, and my white colleagues were completely unaware of the role students played in the civil rights movement. Once I knew that my colleagues didn't know, their lackadaisical response to student protests made sense, right? They're thinking this is a phase or some kind of temper tantrum in response to something the kids want and aren't getting. But it's so much deeper and more complex than a single incident. This is the restrictive view of anti-discrimination Kimberly Crenshaw talks about in her work. Restrictivists view racism as isolated events that happen to individuals rather than social policies and practices that oppress groups of people. Restrictivists want to prevent future discrimination while ignoring historical and present structures that ensure racism persists. So I give this history lesson in hopes of moving people from a restrictivist view towards an expansive view of anti-discrimination. The 1960s saw thousands of college students leaving their institutions to participate in the civil rights movement. These students sacrificed their education in favor of liberation. I'm reminded of the words of Audre Lorde, who said, quote, "If you don't define yourself for yourself, you'll be crunched into other people's fantasies of you and eaten alive," end quote. Our students are being educated at a pivotal moment. This is, though many fear naming it such, a second wave civil rights movement. And like the first, the issues at stake involve real people with real concerns about the unjust ways in which racial, economic, religious, and sexual minorities are disenfranchised by laws and policies meant to uphold racial capitalism. It is our responsibility as not only faculty members who occupy elite positions in society, but as human beings to show our students that their out-of-class lived experiences are at the core of, and not ancillary to, the pursuit of freedom. So today I want to talk about how I've been able to connect students' outside passions to the in-school curriculum in a way that honors and empowers them, rather than in a way that forces them to choose between their intellectual self and their political self. In 2013, Georgetown Center on Education and the Workforce found that between 1995 and 2009, 83% of white freshmen enrolled at one of the top 486 most selective four-year colleges. This is compared to 13% of Hispanics and 9% of African Americans. Instead, 72% of Hispanics and 68% of African Americans enrolled in open access two- and four-year colleges. Further, once these students got to college, 51% of Hispanics and 49% of African Americans dropped out, compared to 30% of white students. The six-year college completion rate for white students is 63%. For black students, 41%. And for Hispanic students, 53%. Only 25% of low-income students complete college within 6 years. Something's wrong. Students from low-income families and students of color are not making it through college, and that's our fault. Somewhere along the way, we forgot that our classrooms have students whose experiences may not be aligned with our own, and thus, we need to adjust our pedagogy to align with their needs, not ours. Social justice pedagogy is a way to do what Geneva Gay says is essential to students' academic success, to teach to and through cultural diversity. To do this, Gay insists that we as educators must be multiculturally conscious and multiculturally competent. To be multiculturally conscious means we are aware not only that people have differences, but that those differences shape ways of being and living. In other words, we cannot acknowledge difference on one hand and then call ourselves colorblind on the other. To be colorblind is to ignore how one's identity influences their day-to-day lived experiences. In the absence of such an analysis, we default to thinking that our own experiences are representative of all experiences. When I first joined my current department, I spent a lot of time educating my colleagues on the perils of a colorblind ideology. While preparing my lunch one day, an older white female adjunct came into the kitchen and wanted to share with me an experience she had at the White Privilege Conference. She says that during a break, she spoke to two older black women who were also in the session she was attending, and she told them that her own department had just hired a young black girl. And that, quote, "We're all very excited to have a more diverse department now." The two black women immediately chastised her for calling me girl. They asked her about my pedigree and why she thought my contribution to the department lay only in my skin color and not my intellect. As she told me this story, she was incredulous that the other women attacked her. She said to me, "I don't see color. I'm not sure why they made the conversation all about race." So a follow-up conversation with her did little to help her understand how offensive and frankly untrue her colorblind approach to life is. It wasn't until after several other incidents in which she compared my afro to pubic hair, she offered me bronzer, and then invited me to a party hosted by her all-white sorority that I finally accepted that I wasn't going to be able to get through to her. Instead, me and another white colleague organized a departmental book club. I currently lead the one for the full-time faculty, and she leads the one for the adjuncts. Our first book was Educated in Whiteness by Angelina Castagno, who's a white woman. After the second meeting, my colorblind colleague came to my office and explained that she now understands why it's wrong to be colorblind and that she was sorry for not getting it sooner. In fact, after every meeting from that point on, she shared with me her new knowledge and hoped that I'd be able to forgive her prior mistakes. I brushed her concerns about forgiveness aside and instead asked her why it took a white woman saying the same thing I said for her to understand. She paused thoughtfully and said, "I don't know." But see, my colleague was able to do what I could not. She was teaching through her cultural frame by using content written by a white woman whose experiences are similar to those of our formerly colorblind colleague. It was the point of racial entry that engendered a type of buy-in I could not. And I'm okay with that, because social justice pedagogy requires that we understand how race, gender, class, sexuality, and religion converge to create intersectional ways of being and living. That's what it means to be multiculturally competent. So while she and I share a gender, the added layers of our identities created distinct experiences that made it difficult for a young black woman to effectively teach an older white female in this instance. But because I am multiculturally competent, I recognize that my perspective is not the perspective. I make it a point to assess my own culturally oriented dispositions. The attitudes, values, and beliefs I bring to the classroom shape my readings, shape how I organize the desk, the types of assignments I give, and certainly how I grade. So the first step in social justice pedagogy is always self-awareness. I was telling Dr. Latson Billings yesterday that I often get unwarranted buy-in from students simply because of how they project their perceptions of the world onto me. This became most clear when I was teaching urban education a few years ago. We were talking about urban renewal or gentrification. And I asked the students how they felt about neighborhoods being torn down and families having to move. One young white male said to me, "It's hard to imagine someone making you leave your own house. Can you tell us what that's like?" I was like, "What?" I'm not sure why prior to this moment I hadn't thought about it, but in that moment I did realize that for my wealthy white students, I was their sole representation of urban. And I was given that descriptor because of my skin color. At the time, I also had an afro that I used to wear up in a puff on top of my head. So for them, I'm exactly what black people look like. So of course, I've had the black experience, and I'm an expert on the subject of urban living. Since then, I've made it a point to account for my physical presentation of self and my teaching, because no matter what I do, my body is politicized in ways to which I have not consented. In that respect, my black body in that white space is an activist effort in itself, because it challenges the students to break from their preconceived notions of blackness and urbanity. Accepting my identity in context is what enables me to do social justice work. Humanist psychologist Carl Rogers implores us to walk into the classroom and to be our real selves. This means dropping the walls that separate them from us and positions us as the expert and they the novices. It means sharing pieces of yourself that allow students to see you as a regular person who chose a career that eventually led to the intersection of your lives. A commitment to social justice means a commitment to humanity, and to model that, you must first be a human who's comfortable saying, "I don't know, I don't understand, and I apologize." Once you're confident in what you bring to the table, the second step involves building relationships with students. It's not enough to simply know their names, majors, and one interesting fact about them. You have to understand how their lives before college affected their self-constructed identities, their chosen academic pursuits, and their self-perceptions. This is much easier at a small institution like mine. I sometimes have students in four different classes in addition to being their thesis advisor. In the absence of repeated exposure, the depth of engagement becomes that much more important. Social justice pedagogy is housed within a Vygotskian framework where a community of learners come to understand themselves through deep engagement with one another and the social context. This pedagogical approach is the antithesis of the sage on the stage, right? It requires that we be humble and open-hearted. Removing interpersonal hierarchies establishes a classroom climate in which you and your students can co-construct knowledge. Once you create the community in the classroom, you can move to step three of understanding the context. Self-perception theory teaches us that the context shapes how we view ourselves and what aspects of ourselves we share with others. Social justice pedagogy is about deconstructing the relationship between oneself and one's location, not just geographically, but also temporally. What was important the last time you taught a class is rarely as important the next time you teach, because you've changed, the students changed, and the context is new. This means that as an educator, it's our responsibility to align our content and our pedagogy to the moment. Connecting our students' academic and intellectual selves to what they call the real world is essential if we are indeed preparing them to be thoughtfully engaged citizens. This, to me, is the most important part of social justice pedagogy because, as I tell my students, if you aren't feeling, you aren't learning. To get my students to feel the content is actually quite easy. If you know them even marginally well, you know what's important to them, you know what kind of experiences they've had, and thus, you can push the boundaries to create a class in which you challenge what's important to them and give them new experiences. What's more tricky is deciding which emotions will best facilitate your learning objectives. When doing social justice pedagogy, there's a fine line between feeling and being emotional. Because I teach about the ways in which whiteness and poverty prohibit equitable educational opportunities, I have to be careful about making students feel guilty. Right? The goal of social justice pedagogy is not to blame, but to empower. Empowerment comes in step four, through the actual learning. One of the ways that social justice pedagogy differs from other types of instruction is in how the academic content connects to the experiential learning. The most common way teachers get students to experience content is through service learning, right? This is when students are required to do some type of community service that is marginally related to course content. But social justice pedagogy is much more about community-based learning, which differs from service learning in two key ways. First, community-based learning is reciprocal. We don't send our all-knowing students from the college on the hill to interact with locals and provide a service that, in our estimation, they can't do themselves. Instead, community-based learning is about establishing relationships with community members in which they tell us what they need and how we can help them. And in return, they share their cultural knowledge and skills with students. In essence, community-based learning positions our students as apprentices rather than saviors. The second way community-based learning differs from service learning is in its connection to academic content. Instead of being an ad hoc or supplemental experience, students' work in and for the community is an integrated component of the curriculum. Just as books and articles are listed under course readings on a syllabus, so are the experiences they have with community partners. The same way we reflect on readings during class, we must also spend time debriefing students' experiences through the lens of academic theories, and most of all, in relation to their own subjectivities. Our essential question in social justice pedagogy is always, how and why have you changed? These types of questions form the core of assessments. Multiple choice exams and other content-focused assignments divert students' attention from the process to the outcome. We must instead keep them personally engaged with the content by assigning tasks that require reflexive, not reflective, thinking. Anthropologists do this naturally. But to those of us whose disciplines are less people-oriented, centering personal development can be difficult. In my own community-based learning courses, I ask students to create community maps, record podcasts, film documentaries, write curriculum, and many other tasks from which someone else might benefit. There are certainly levels of depth when it comes to connecting students to the real world. Indeed, my most immersive course is a class called The Tradition of African American Education and the Black Bourgeoisie. I take students from my PWI in Colorado to Nashville, Tennessee, where we spend the entire course living in dorms at Fisk University. They take classes at Fisk and Tennessee State, but the true content of the course is about them understanding how living and learning looks different for different people in different environments. Their final project is done in collaboration with Fisk students, where they engage in some kind of activism by mobilizing other students and community members to participate in an event that they've planned. When I taught this course 2 years ago, their projects included a health clinic in partnership with Meharry Medical College students, food drives at local churches, a second grade field trip to the Civil Rights Museum in Memphis, a film screening and discussion on sexuality in the Black community, a workshop on urban gardening at a community center, and a documentary on the merits of HBCUs. In their final autoethnographies, my students share how they changed in the last 4 weeks. My only blonde student titled her paper, "Whose Hair Is That in the Drain?" And through tears, she told us how for the first time she understood what it was like to be the only. She felt how it feels to be the object of everyone's attention when you walk in the room and to carry the weight of representing your race. She learned how to respond to the stereotypes and assumptions people made about a white girl from New Jersey who attends college in a state where both the weed and the snow are plentiful. One of my Black female students from Southside Chicago talked about her feelings of elation to be back in a space where she didn't have to worry about anything except her learning. She talked about feeling comfortable in her own skin and not being afraid of participating in class because she didn't think the Black professors at Fisk would judge her the way her own professors do at Colorado College. She concluded her paper by stating that she now knows what intellectual freedom feels like. But not all of my courses are this intense. My most lightweight community-based learning course is Educational Research Methods. Here, my students dip their toes into the water of social justice, primarily by investigating the outcomes of inequitable educational opportunities. Throughout the course, my students gather and analyze data from two demographically different public schools in the same district. And for their final, they deliver a presentation to the school district's Director of Data and Accountability, along with a strategic plan for improvement. Such small acts may not appear to be related in any way to activism, but I assure you they are. In the words of your own Dr. Michael Apple, teaching is not an act of reproduction. It is an act of contradiction. It is the way we can softly or not so softly push back against the established routines of interpreting and constructing knowledge. It is the way to target the unique needs of those involved and leverage their positionality to facilitate change. In my urban education course, I focus on my students' wealth as a point of entry to help them understand what it's like to not have something and to be positioned so that you can never attain it. In my Nashville course, I use the space to create an experience that challenges students' conceptualizations of learning and the purpose of an education. In the methods class, my focus is not on my students, but on the community partner, who needs a gentle nudge toward creating more equitable learning opportunities for the Black and brown students they serve. In all cases, I am complicating what is and opposing notions of what will be. In that way, social justice pedagogy is about widening my students' lens to incorporate images or elements of images that were hitherto unseen. Teaching, therefore, is inherently activist work. Though we may not be standing in front of a courthouse or calling our senators or marching in the streets, teaching is an act of revolution against normalization. Social justice pedagogy is not about equal outcomes. It's about teaching students how to think and behave in socially just ways. It's about allowing social issues to shape or infiltrate the content of your course. It is a privilege to invoke claims of academic freedom while our students feel imprisoned by the very institution advertised to liberate them. It is no wonder that institutions of higher education have historically and continue to be the birthplace of youth activism. Activism starts with education. Even if you don't care much for the former, the latter should be your utmost priority. If SNCC and CORE taught us anything, it's that when given choice, students can and do commit to important issues. I end by once again referencing Dr. Apple, who poses the question, can education change society? It depends, he says. It depends on a lot of hard collective and individual work. In my estimation, we must first do the individual work and then engage the collective alongside our students. Thank you so much for coming. So, questions?
Can Can you give an example or describe the difference that you gave of reflexive versus reflective?
Absolutely. Okay, I can't stand here anymore. So reflection is very much about looking back, right, and thinking about what I did and what happened. It's very external to yourself, right? Reflexive work is much more about looking forward and thinking about how, because of what happened, I'm different now, right? So I tell the students it turns the lens of analysis inward. And they actually have a very, very difficult time with this. My pre-service teachers, I asked them to write a cultural autoethnography, and they can't do it, right? Because most of them have never paused and thought about how they are cultural beings and what makes them cultural beings. But they can whip out a paper about somebody else, right? And they can whip out a paper about their history. So I'm like, I don't want an autobiography. Right, I want a cultural autoethnography, which is the study of yourself in a cultural context. Other questions? Yes, ma'am.
It sounds like you're teaching some really innovative and different kind of ways. And you did you not mention that you maybe weren't teaching exactly what they thought you were gonna, have you gotten pushback?
I have not, but that's a function of my institution. Okay. We are pretty much allowed to do whatever we want. Okay. I'm a psychologist by training. But I was hired as a postdoc to teach ed psych and some other courses. I ended up getting hired tenure track in the ed department. And I don't know what they thought I was going to teach, but this is what I'm doing. And it's worked out fine. Yeah.
Is that a regime change in CC?
Yes. So in some ways, we see change because our president has made it a mission of the institution to become much more inclusive. But from the kind of other grassroots direction, it's not just myself who kind of engages in this type of work. A few other faculty are really structuring their classes around connecting the students to real world issues. And so what we see is the students start to push back on the faculty who are not doing that, right? And so you can imagine it's created tensions amongst us, right? When students come and say, in Manya's class, right, we did X, Y, and Z. Nobody ever wants to hear that as a professor. But what's happening is that because we're so small, it is kind of trickling out. And so I have faculty from the math department ask, you know, can you help me be more inclusive in my classes? I don't know how to do this on my own. So it's working, slow change, but it's change. Yeah. Yes, ma'am.
I imagine that the same national events that we've seen on campuses with the uptick in hate crimes mm-hmm. and the pushback are happening on your campus
Indeed.
As well. How are you bringing that into the classroom, and how are your students engaging with their own reality on their campus in that way?
That's a good question. So last fall, 2015, we did have an incident on Yik Yak. I don't know if you're familiar with that, like, online platform. People can post anonymously, and obviously that means they get really brave. They have e-courage is what I call it. And so with this e-courage, some of our students posted things like, black people need to go back to the cotton fields, they're better off as slaves, why don't you just go to HBCUs, black women aren't hot, but they're stupid enough to think they are, like all these types of comments. And I knew that my kids were hurting. So the next 2 days of class, whatever I was gonna do is not what I did. Right, we very much sat and talked about, you know, what can you do, right? You let them process through the emotions, move them from anger and hurt towards empowerment. And so I actually sat with students and helped them write a letter to the president. And she met with them on a Saturday afternoon. And then they created a petition that outlined all the things that they wanted changed. And over half of the students at the college, again, it was only 2,200 students. So we're talking about more than 1,000 kids signed this. And presented it to the Faculty Senate, where it was well received by some and not by others. But that was kind of the first spark that kind of created institutional change in terms of diversified hiring. We're currently redoing our curriculum, getting away with some requirements that students identified as particularly problematic. And then I told someone yesterday that when the Baltimore riots were happening, I didn't have class that day either. Right, I asked the students, because I was upset, and I can't be a good teacher when I'm in my feelings. So I came in and I said, you know, we're gonna do something different today. Raise your hand if you can tell me what's going on in Baltimore. And besides the three students who I knew would know, the rest had no clue. So we opened our laptops, looked some stuff up. We talked about representation from different news sources. examples of how they've seen this on campus and in their own lives. And then the next day we got back on track, right? So in it's very much for me, I have no problem stopping a traditional content to address what matters in the moment. Yes?
So this is not necessarily a fair question.
Oh, great, thank you.
I just want you to speculate a little bit. So you've gotten students to stop and have reflexive moments, mm-hmm. but in these institutions, a lot of the momentum rests with faculty and what faculty do. Do you have insights on how to get faculty to have some of those reflexive moments?
We had to change, so we're self-governing. So it takes us to vote, and it does not require a supermajority, just a majority, to change anything. And so what happened was a bunch of the untenured faculty got together, put forth a petition to our dean, who serves as our provost. She brought it to the faculty floor, and basically the petition was, we want to change some of the questions on our course evaluation rubrics, which at a teaching institution are heavily, heavily weighted in your tenure and promotion processes. We also changed the language on our websites. We changed some course descriptions and course titles. Like, I had a class in my department called Educating At-Risk Youth or Mentoring At-Risk Youth. One of the first things I did, literally from the first 2 weeks I was in that department, I was like, we don't call them at-risk youth. I don't know what that means. Those are just words, right? So we eradicated that. We have not passed a resolution on changing the course evals, but what's interesting, right, what it has done is it's forced people to out themselves. Right, you only care if you think it's going to hurt you. You don't care if you're like, it doesn't matter one way or the other if we add two or three questions here. I know I'm great, I'm doing that. So what happens is the people who know they aren't doing it are the ones who have to stand in front of the full faculty and the administration and say, I don't want to do that, and here's why. Right, so now they're feeling some type of way, and they're the ones who are secretly emailing me for help. So we kind of have to backdoor it to get faculty buy-in. And it's always about creating something that is going to hurt or harm them in some way. And that's sad that that's how we have to create buy-in, but that's what we have to do. Other questions or comments?
So I'm guessing you have a fair number of students who don't think they're paying $64,000 for this, for what you're doing.
What's interesting is that they love it. I am basically one of the top three faculty members on campus ranked by the students. They like it because for them, many of them have never been asked to think about these issues, and they are really genuinely warm-hearted kids, right? And they want to do right by the world. And so while they find it incredibly challenging, they find it incredibly engaging. And so I actually cannot identify a single time where after the course I had a student who didn't like it. Now, at the beginning of a class, they're like, oh, this isn't what I thought it was. I thought we were learning about whatever. But I say within a week, which is a third of our course time, they're on board and engaged. So it's actually not, I don't get as much pushback as you would think from the students. Now, from their parents is different. Yeah, so the parents, they don't contact me directly, thankfully. But they try to contact my bosses, right, my chair and my dean, and say, my daughter, so I have my pre-service teachers do video blogs or vlogs about whatever they want. There's no guide, right? It's just turn in one every day by 7 a.m. And they on their own last year were interviewing family members about their beliefs about class and gender and all these other issues. And in their video blogs, they basically, and they post them on YouTube, right? And the students control whether or not they're public or private. So one student posted hers, didn't make it private, her family saw it. And what they saw was her saying, oh my God, my family's racist, and I had no idea. And I'm terrified because they raised me, I'm probably racist too and don't know it, and I'm a classroom teacher. So her family saw that and then tried to tell on me that I somehow did that. Right, so it's really just the parents who don't particularly think that they're paying $64,000 to get this. But usually the student can intervene and be like, okay, mom, you're overreacting, just be quiet. And it works out fine. Yeah.
How much do things like your budget busters exercise serve? I mean, like, you're talking about points of entry. It seems like...
That's a huge point of entry. Right, because I have to let them know what they don't know before I can do my job. Right, and I can't just be like, you don't know this, right? That's not really good teaching. So I have to allow them to experience what they don't know. So in that budget busters exercise, they didn't know how to calculate interest. They thought interest was calculated once a year, I was like, oh, if only, right? And then they get irate. They're super engaged because, and I'm very intentional about who gets which scenario, right? So again, I know enough about them to know who went to Swiss boarding school and has an au pair versus who has had a job since they were 14, right? So I'm careful to give them scenarios that challenge what they, how they think the world works. And so I often, every time I do it, I have at least one group, the group who realizes that no matter what they do, they can never get out of debt, right? And they are outraged, like angry with me. And I'm like, I didn't do it, right? They're like, this is, I can never pay off anything. I just have paid a minimum balance. I don't have enough money. And I say, welcome to the United States, right? And you can see they're like, oh my God, is this what's going on? And then I can move forward to help them understand how to apply that lens to educational issues.
Being not from the education field, could you guide us through like what kind of questions you ask in terms of your final project in, or in terms of generating an autoethnography?
For the autoethnography, I only have one guiding question, and it's, why are you the way you are right now? Why are you this person right now? I tend to back off of giving them a lot of questions and all that stuff, because then the students, I have really high achieving students, and they want to give me what they think I want, right? So when I give them those guiding questions, they just try to go through and answer them, and then it loses the originality and the intent of the assignment is for you to tell me what you think is important. I can't tell you what you think is important from this course or in your own upbringing, right? And so I explain to them that part of what I'm assessing is their ability to look inside and identify something that matters. So they'll turn in some superficial, surface level stuff, and I won't read it. Or I'll just give it back to them the next day and say, this doesn't matter, pick something else that matters. Right, and then they're like, oh, okay, right. With their final projects, in the CBL courses, they decide what to do with their community partner. So often the community partner says, this is what my community center needs, and then the students do that. With the FISC class, I don't know how they came up with those ideas. Once again, I just say these are the boundaries of what you're expected to do, go forth. And then I've discovered that they do a much better job when I don't tell them what to do. They're more engaged. They'll work much harder making, if you ever make a documentary that's even like 8 minutes, which isn't really a documentary, but it is for them, that amount of time that goes into making an 8 minute movie far exceeds what goes into studying for an exam or writing a paper. And it forces the students to manipulate and apply the course content in a way that they're not used to doing. So the pushback I do get on course evals is very much, Manya has high expectations, and it's not always clear what she wants. And I say, because I don't want anything in particular, right? I can't communicate that because it doesn't exist. I don't know what you want to give me. I don't know how you want to demonstrate your learning. So I very much let them figure that piece out. Yes, ma'am.
So as a parent too, whose daughter had Manya as a faculty member, I remember when she did that exercise and she sent it to me.
She did it twice.
I know, that's what I'm going to say. And I looked at it and I knew it was just really superficial. And I said, so you sent it back to her and she's crying and she's, I don't know what she wants. And so I said, you know, just look at what you're trying to say in there. And sure enough, it started to come out. I still felt she could have done a little bit better. But I think that then as my daughter went on to have other professors, she was so challenged by Manya and the way she made her think in a different way. And today, now teaching, she does the same exact thing. So, you know, you set the bar high. I think you did set it high among other faculty members. I remember she came and she was upset because this one other faculty member wasn't challenging her. And I think you even had to step in of looking at things in a different way. And I so appreciate how you've done that. And I think as educators, we need to look at doing that. Many of the things you're talking about are also progressive education. Mm-hmm. Pretty much that's how I'm able to teach also, because it is hard when we're not able to teach outside the box and we have to teach exactly there. But there are ways that you can go outside that, I really feel. Mm-hmm. So, but yes, it's a great exercise.
Yes, And her daughter actually did it in two separate classes. And one she did as a freshman or like a first semester sophomore, and the other as a graduating senior. And she said, I went back and looked at what I did a few years ago. I thought I could just like fix it up, right? And adjust it a bit. And she was like, I didn't do it because it was terrible. She's like, so I started completely over. And there were probably, the general theme was the same, but it was a completely different analysis of it. And as a teacher, like I said, I have these students multiple times. I get to see their growth, right? And that is what's gratifying to me, is to say, wow, right? And I had her paper from before, and when I gave the new one back, I gave her the old one with it. And I was like, you need to always keep these two things together as a model, right? Or as evidence that you are always moving forward. And so, you know, in a year from now, I'm going to contact her and ask her to do it again, right? After she's been a classroom teacher, she has her master's degree, to see how this is a progression. And just because you leave my 3.5-week class doesn't mean you can't continue this work on your own. Here's another question. Yes, ma'am.
I'm just curious. I love when you were saying the perils of a colorblind ideology. And so I'm just curious how you hope students move from this belief in a common humanity mm-hmm. towards differentiating and understanding the goals and values of understanding racial, cultural, ethnic differences.
So what's interesting is that my undergraduates, I have no problem. They don't have that ideology, right? And I'm grateful for that. My pre-service teachers, who are second career teachers, they have it, and then my colleagues have it. And the first thing I usually try to do is give them an example that uses them. So with the woman I was talking about, when she came in my office, she's probably like this tall. And I said to her, okay, well, if I ran around with this type of blind, right, say I was height blind, but I'm in charge of designing buildings, right? I wear heels every day. I'm easily 6 feet tall, sometimes 6'1". So if I'm gonna design something, I'm gonna put a light switch right here. That's convenient for me. Right, the peephole in the door is going to be right here, so I can see it. I said, so every time that you want to turn a light on or look out your door, you have to bring a chair and stand on top of it. I was like, so in me being blind to your needs, I've created a system and a structure in which you have to have an extra hurdle, take an extra step to succeed. It didn't work with her. She was like, well, I would just bring the chair over. And that's really when I was like, we're done here. I have nothing else. Right, but for most people, something like that is actually effective to get them to understand, oh, right, because your first instinct is to say, I treat everybody the same. And I say, well, everybody doesn't have the same needs, so why would you do that? Right, in graduate school, again, with Dr. Milner, and this was, I went straight through, right, so I was a 21-year-old first-year PhD student. And so I had him in this class, and I went to Dartmouth for undergrad, and I never took any class about kind of racial issues at all. And so we came in on the first day, and he had us each take off a shoe. And he didn't say anything about it. He just take a shoe off. I was like, okay, right. And he went on with class for an hour and a half. And at the end of class, he was like, all right, I'm gonna give you your shoes back, right? So he goes to the pile, picks up a shoe, just hands them out at random, right? And he's like, why aren't y'all leaving? Bye, I'll see you on Thursday. And we're like, well, we need our shoe. And he was like, why? I gave everybody a shoe. You all got the same thing, a shoe. Right, so that's how he was teaching us the difference between equality and equity. He's like, you have a shoe that fits you, that matches the other one, that's the one you need, right? And that's equity. So sometimes I'll do that activity with my pre-service teachers, and that helps them a lot. So it's really just finding, again, that entry point where they can put themselves in the position of the one who's being, you know, disenfranchised in some way, and then it seeps in.
Yes,